So I'm changing hats now as a sort of coordinator to just be one of the participants. And I've chosen the theme, which is disability and visual arts. So what have we been doing all the arts? Well, we have been doing the arts. We looked at blue image, we looked at language and theatre. We have the thing, the visual. But because of the work with DACA and the disability arts movement, that's why we're doing visual arts. So we'll go wide. Is the history of the visual representation. And, you know, the urge to portray, paint, carve, sculpt, our existence has always been there from cave paintings 400,000 years ago onwards. The work hasn't been done to see were there sufficient representations of people who have missed a leg, an arm, or whatever. We don't know. The research hasn't been done. But we begin to see that there is a huge amount of stuff there to track. Go through collections in all the main museums of the world, you'll find there's a huge amount of stuff. I don't think that people have really looked at a lot of this. So having a camera has always been part of human condition, and it always will be. How do these realities interact? Well, for instance, this Ice Age carving, is she just obese from it, or should she say, who knows? Or this Santa, who was 4,500 years ago in ancient Greece, was clearly a high official, but he was a person of significant short stature. And in Egyptian culture generally, disabled people were venerated, partly because they thought sometimes they had godlike status, but blind people also. Or in this Indian Hindu culture, we find that Asava Kara. He's in there right from the beginning of the religious books. He's got eight different impairments, and there's a whole moral tale about people beginning to see him for his impairment and rejecting him, but then taking him on board because of his wise counsel. But there are portrayals of him all over the Indian subcontinent and beyond. Well, this person with Down syndrome in a Peruvian vase, what's the story behind that? Who knows? This last one from the lateral Psalter, that dates wrong, should be 1325, sort of like that. Is this a joke that all these people with impairments are trying to do something on the ground, or is it not? Difficult to know, but no one's done the analysis. Then we've got more modern day things, a picture here from David Healy, who's the coordinator of the NACA project. Director of the chief executive show. But this is a comment from the 80s. Are we to be treated like bits of meat in a wheelchair? You know, so we've got this whole range of era representation. I wanted to try and deconstruct some of that. So if we go back to ancient Egypt, they had a god called Bez, who was a short stature. When I put it in italics, that's words we don't like to use, but words of common parlance, like dwarf. He's the god of dreams, dancing, celebrated as a protector of women. And in birthing chambers, there are many pictures of him around the wall to make it safe for women to give birth. He had a partner called Beset, who had similar powers. The many hieroglyphics and sculptures of the Egyptian period, the veneration of blind people, blind harp player. These was also not just in Egypt, but across the Roman Empire as well. This idea of motive figures showing the person's impairment that you wanted to appeal to the gods to get rid of. So you did carvings of yourself or that you didn't want to be found or that you were, and hoped by burying and appealing to the gods these would go away. Or the last one is a tablet which is all about saying, we don't want to be deaf, thank you, can you take it away? And so this is very much part of these older ancient cultures. Coming on to the Greek culture, which is important in two ways, in its own way, but much of the post-Renaissance culture was rediscovering the ancient classics. So there was a huge recession. You look at these Greek stories, and whether it's Troy, the big movie, or whatever, they're still recycled over and over again. And what was the attitude there to disabled people? Well, we know that the attitude was not a good one. That Plato Odysseus escapes the Polynicus, his cave, by hanging onto a ram, that second picture there, and then gets past him. Homer is believed to have been a lion sage, and this is another stereotype that we get coming out over and over again. Lion people somehow have extra sight into the affairs of the world, they can find out what's going on, they can foretell the future. I don't know if it's true, do you, Henry?
Well, I
think it's
absolutely true.
Hephaestus is an interesting tale. This is off a Greek vase. It shows his club foot. Club foot, not a major repair, and these days can be adjusted with a small amount of surgery. Though there are still terminations taking place in Britain because people are diagnosed as having a club foot, which is, you know, it tells you something about kind of a perfect body image that is still around and is often portrayed in what we're looking at. But Hephaestus is thrown out of heaven by his mother. That, you know, he's not fit for purpose, but he didn't drown because he's immortal, so he had to come back. And unlike the other gods, he had to work with him as a blacksmith, so he developed enormous upper body strength. The Romans called him Vulcan, but it's the same thing. He was the origin of thunder and lightning, and they explained that these fights in the heavens were to do with the other gods trying to steal his wife, Aphrodite, who he had forced his mother Hera to give him by putting her in a chair and imprisoning her and let her go until he got the best looker, to put a sexist phrase on it, on the mountain. But then the other gods didn't think he was justified as quite a cripple to have her. And so very early stereotypes coming out there, disabled people as non-sexual, and so on. And then contrast to this, Patiocos was a figure you'll find in many of the Greek islands and so on. You touch it, it gives you good luck. So there are very contradictory ideas coming out of these cultures. And then the Romans were along the same line. We had, they thought it quite fun to have short gladiators or hunchback gladiators fighting women or fighting animals in the ring. But they also seem to have omens to keep the evil eye away, particularly if they had a large phallus. That somehow is very much part of these pictures. The short person with the large phallus to keep the evil eye away. And then, of course, they did have one or two emperors who were disabled. Julius Caesar had epilepsy. Claudius, who probably had cerebral palsy. But interestingly, in all the sculptures you can find of Claudius, you can't see his deformity, as they would put it then. And this one, far right here, is covered up by his coat. So we see this, again, this mixed picture in the representations of these periods. And then coming on to the sort of medieval period, and I've limited this to Europe, really, and gone by at the beginning, because it just doesn't fit it in. And we will try and do a few more paragraphs before the year is finished on some other cultures and how they're going. But we're focusing now really on European, largely. Obviously, the representation of the medieval period was the period before that, the so-called Dark Ages, which are becoming increasingly less dark, but we still have a lot of information about it. So, from about 1,000 years ago, we're looking at what representations were. And in this, we're guided by frescoes, mosaics, and manuscripts. Illustrated manuscripts were the main things. There weren't many paintings around at this time. And here you can see a number of different ones. William, who was William the First, who was a person who invaded the Normans, I think went down to Sicily as well, and there he built a cathedral at Montreal, and then full of mosaics, and two of them are about Christ healing the lepers, so this becomes a very strong theme. The next one there, which comes from Bulgaria, takes a different thing, taken up by a bed of war, where Christ supposedly healed a paralytic, i.e. someone who was spinally injured. And then was so fit after the miracle that he could take out the wooden bed he was lying in and could walk away with it. And this is reproduced often, or here we have from St. William, this is a stained glass window in York, and he's given sight to someone who's blind. It wasn't just Christ himself, there was any relics of Christ, hairs of Christ, nails from being on the cross, or any saints who have followed him. And all of these people could perform miracles. And here we have the knights in Jerusalem carrying the supposed Holy Grail. And you can see on the corner there, the person who's with the walking stick in his hand has been cured by actually carrying the Holy Grail. So this story is a very familiar one that we keep coming back to. And in medieval life, it's interesting that most people across Europe who were disabled would just get on with it the same as everybody else. And that's the main thing that we get from the portrayals of the world, so various denominations. Sometimes making fun of them, that's, I would say, the second one there, the knight who's got various impairments, is that done for humour? The guy who's got the walking aids, the woman who's being pushed around on a barrow, and then we've got the disabled people at the top there, two blind person and bad people, as they put it, on their way to Mount St. Michel to, again, cure. And of course, one of the most famous works of literature in England, The Canterbury Tales, is about people, and there are a number of disabled people on that pilgrimage who are going to have cures in Canterbury. So it's very much part of the culture, and we'll come back to a picture of that a bit later on. This one's quite interesting. I found a couple of pictures or manuscripts where demons were leaving people. And this is around, really, we have to interpret as getting rid of psychosis, getting rid of mental health, and naming that. And you can see the little demons there leaving the person. So they're not dealing with mental health issues 800 years ago. They're actually picking these up and saying, well, these are being exorcised. And it's actually quite difficult to deal with invisible impairments visually, but that's a good way of actually dealing with it, showing here's the little demon who's inside people's heads going off. The Renaissance doesn't just start at a certain date. As trade relations break down, begin to accelerate, and the old feudal system that tied people to the land, apart from the laws, began to break down as trade went on. It was a period of about 300 or 400 years where more and more trade came, more and more accumulation. It wasn't just lords who were doing it, but in Italy, in the city-states, we see the first capitalists who were actually just accumulating wealth for its own sake. And they had money. So once they had money, you could have trained artists in studios, apprenticeships were what it was a craft, it wasn't anything else. You learned how to do it on a 7-year apprenticeship, assigned to someone who already knew how to do it, and then a few of those people developed new ways of doing it, new ways to see it, if you like, and that became interesting. And perhaps one of the first people to do that was Giotto, who around 1300 started showing off people in the Byzantine way, the old way, that they were one-dimensional characters. These were real people who were showing up, put halos all over his pictures as here, but they were very different from the pictures that had come before. And then from the apprentices that we had in Italy, and then later on moving to Holland and Belgium, the Low Countries, and across the Channel, we begin to see this. And most of those people were shown full frontal to the artist's view. There's one person you can find several pictures of, the Duke Federico Urbino. And because there was this idea of the Renaissance, so going back to the Greek and classical form, everything perfect, perfect symmetry. And of course, the people who just go back one, these people who were ordinary people around, they were covered in smallpox sores, bunions, injured, there were wars going on the whole time, there would be large numbers of impaired people throughout the society. They were not shown. By and large, not shown. It was an idealized form, airbrushed out, you know, a white wash across the face, and everyone had perfect complexion. Not true. And this is underlined by the Duke Frederick Urbino, who was a mercenary, if you like, got himself a castle and so on out of it. But in his on his right side, he had a slash right across here, taking out his eye. He was never shown with it. Always the good side, never the so-called bad side. And then we have some of the most famous artists of the Renaissance period, Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo. There's a good amount of evidence now in the Lancet and other medical journals that they had, both of them had all the characteristics of someone on the autistic spectrum, Asperger's syndrome probably, not making social relationships, obsessed with their work and just getting on with it, working in an excessive amount and so on compared to other artists of the day. They don't portray anything of that in their art, but it'd be interesting to really go back and investigate how much that did impact on it. It'd be interesting to see. And of course they were both what are called Renaissance men or people, although we really figure in most of this, I have to say. Which is, you know, I'm sure it is, there's a hidden history there that needs to be got out. But they meant that they weren't just artists, they were scientists, engineers, and so on. They were everything. They could do everything. That's because of their autism. With the most common Southern European representation, when you see disabled people at all for this 400-year period, was when someone was doing miracles. So here we have on the left, we have Augustine healing the lame, and on the right, a Brembo picture, the old Tintoretto, Christ healing the blind. And you can find literally hundreds of these if you want to find them. So there are disabled people throughout, and they're only shown as being cured from their impairment by some miraculous cure. The Reformation brought a slightly different, more realistic portrayal. That is the shift of Protestantism in Northern Europe, Germany, Holland, Belgium, and mixed amount in Britain, where we see the artists actually going out and painting and making pictures of the people they saw around, such as this sketch by Bosch of the cripples, and he used some of those sketches in his Garden of Earthly Delights. If you look closer, you can see some of them in there portrayed. But more importantly, the Bruegels, Elder and Junior, you call that himself Junior, but he was his son, they were both called Peter. The Blind Leading the Blind, which is on a parable, which is that's why it's painted for us to laugh at blind people, one falling over the next, over the next, over the next. Brings us right up to date with Mr. Magoo cartoons, same thing. It's okay to laugh at people who've got poor sight. No, it is, but you know, that's the message there. Or this other picture he did, the cripples, and no, the fox tails are pinned to their backs. This is a sign of evil that they've got on their backs. Then Peter Bruegel the Younger took a sketch of his son, the Seven Acts of Mercy, and there are loads of disabled people in that. And there are lots of their pictures that include disabled people, not just for cures, but as a moral message, but also acknowledging in a way that, of course, there are disabled people in the community. They've always been there, they've always will be. So in a way, their pictures do at least include us, maybe not as we want to be included. Well, back a little bit was an artist called Mantegna, who was Italian, and he produced quite a lot of pictures with what looks like something with Down syndrome features. And it's thought that he probably had a child in his family with Down syndrome, and he painted them as a model. There were four or five of those pictures that he actually did. On the other hand, this wasn't the only one to do the ship before, looking at people with learning difficulties. It was used in two ways. First of all, as a metaphor for being ridiculous, being hopeless, and doing all the wrong things. So the ship of fools was often parody of government going wrong, or the church going wrong. But it was meant to be people who had learning difficulties or had the features of people with learning difficulties. And then we got with Henry VIII in his favourite picture, we don't know who this is attributed to, and it's not a factual picture, because in it you can see his three children, Prince Edward, Prince Elizabeth and Prince Mary, and his wife, who by this time was dead, Jane Seymour. So these are presumably the favourite people in his six marriages. And in the two wings there, two people were learning difficulties, two were jesters at the court, who was quite a feature. And in the broadsheet, we do a link to a whole series of work I was involved in, rediscovering how fools were used to act at court. the Tudors believed that people with learning difficulties had a direct line to God. So if you heard something from someone with learning difficulty, that was the truth. And so the king found it quite useful to have around to ask them questions on that sort of thing. Speed up. We get with the development of the printing press from around the late part of the 1400s, 1480, Caxton and so on. It had been done used in China a lot before, but it came to Europe around that time. We didn't just have individual hand-drawn things that we had in the manuscripts, we didn't have individual sketches, we had mass production of images for the first time. And if you remember, at this time only the wealthy and the clerics could read. The way of mass communication that we first had was the cartoon. So what were the images that were in this mass, the first mass media, if you like, were, and this is one from 1600, which is called The Dangers of Love. And I think it's probably big enough to see at the top there you've got the lovers meeting in some sort of idyllic place and having a kiss and a cuddle and maybe more. And what happens underneath where all sorts of demons and things start having a go. And you can see there are crutches there and there are sores on their legs. Maybe it's saying you're in syphilis, who knows? But anyway, that's The Dangers of Love. But not content with that, we go on to the second part of this, and there you have all sorts of supernatural forces punishing the lovers, and in the end, the lover, the male lover, is taken off to the insane asylum in a sedan chair with a blanket over his head. Now, the only copy of this in Britain is at Windsor Castle Library, and I sometimes wonder whether the Queen might have shown her children this as they're growing up or not. Probably not. They might have not made it the way it is. Who knows? I'm not going to moralise that. But it's interesting, this was a moral thing. You see the lines in it because it can be folded up. It expands. And so you can take it out if you're feeling tempted, take it out and have a little look at this, and maybe you'll stick to the straight and narrow. But a very strong moral message, something that's massively reproduced all over Europe. And then if you look at cartoons, these are getting more unfair, but yeah. Mitelli was an Italian etcher engraver who basically, along with John Collett, who was another one from France, concentrated almost entirely in reproducing images of disabled people. And there was a message in this, mainly dwarfs, quotes. Here we have the hut, this is the art school of the dwarfs, and who's the model? The hunchback. So, you know, this is all about they're over there, we're here, we feel better because they're there. But then the next one, Roman de Hoogh, 1701. Here we have Louis XIV, the Sun King. He never used crutches, but his state power was weakened by the Dutch lion attacking the chariot of state. And who is driving the chariot but his mistress, who many people believe bear his throne. If you watch Versailles, and I watched Versailles, all of this is in there, 10 programs that you can still see. The whole history of this, where he went to war rather foolishly against Holland and got beaten, and meanwhile his mistress was doing all sorts of things. But this was in the public domain, and he was sort of using his ability to show his weakness. And this is a very strong thing that comes out in these cartoons. But by Hogarth, Hogarth used a lot of disabled characters, nearly all of us. There's a whole story in that I've got from a historian who's been working on it, which is up on the website, and you know more about it. But in all of his big pictorial stories, the race progress and so on, it's all about this ability. Here we have idleness and work, and here in print 6, the house is now on the one side with a rich person who's been working, has got money to give to charity. On the other side of the street is a character who was found around called Billy in a Bowl, who was a character who had a bowl he sat in and moved himself along. And on that side of it is the people that are idle and don't get on with it. So again, it's a very strong old tale. In Gin Street and Beer Street, you can see the same polarisation going on all the way through the 18th century. And it's a very strong underpinning of the attitudes we deal with today on disability, because people inherit their views on physical and mental difference, and this is where they come from. And then going on, Gilray, who was a pornographer as well as doing political cartoons, which is mainly sourcing drawings if you want to. But here is Harry, the Napoleonic Wars, and John Bull, who's the personification of Britain, goes off to war, he's fat, overweight, eating roast beef, drinking beer, he goes off, comes back much thinner, and of course, disabled. In other words, Britain has been weakened by this war. So it's using political bath phrases by Robinson and other cartoonists of that period. It later into the Regency period, we see bath races, lots of rich people particularly over-consuming, got gout and so on, and went to take the waters in the bath, which people from Roman times have been going there for the curative effect of these waters. These are not waters like Lourdes, where you go to have a miracle cure. These are waters that are meant to have a good medicinal effect on you, because they've got sulfur in them and other things. But anyway, it clearly hasn't had an effect on these ones, so racing down the hill and us all falling over each other. And then recently, we've got our own cartoonist, John Lennon in America, or Cribbage here, who turned this around. And here he's making a joke about people saying, oh, foot and mouth paint. I wonder what this guy would know answers. Well, I've all done this bit of paper, does that count? We're reclaiming back our own humour into this situation. In the Greek, we have, in the broadsheet, I've got a picture of Two-Face in Batman. You know, Two-Face, one side good, one side bad. In all of these Marvel comics, morality is brought down to how people look. And this reinforces it for new generations of children. So it's not as if this is going away. It still looks bad, looks bad, good, looks good. No, it doesn't. And that's what the message from all of these cartoons, all of the films, huge amounts of films, and again, we're slightly redoing the Grimm's Tales, Snow White, and so on. Interestingly, in the last version of Snow White, and moving into film, and the books you can see, you always have the short people, the dwarves, where they're living, in the forest, away from everybody else. They are outcasts. And I'm sure, I'm afraid, that the latest Hollywood version of this, they're worse than that. They don't even have a personality, because they have got heads. Non-disabled actors on people of short stature bodies, and they are the characters. So the disabled actors aren't even allowed to be characters, they're just body doubles. What a shocking thing, really, if you think about it. 2012, that film was made. So this is a very long history that goes on. Now look at a few artists who have maybe broken mold future disabled people a bit more. The court artist Vlasov did a lot of court paintings, but I featured here. He also painted the jesters and other people in the royal household. This is quite common in European household. There were a lot of disabled people there to amuse. That's what they were there for, to amuse the clowns, and occasionally the sage. But even the royal family, the Mignes, which is a very famous painting, which Picasso and many other people have spent a lot of time remodeling. So I think there are 57 varieties of this, but this was the princess with her, and two short people in the court. You see the artists on the left, and in the background you see the king and queen looking through the door. Very famous painting, but a lot of disability in there, and you know, lots of things you can do. And these others, we've got more there, various people around the court, buffoons. A hundred years later, we've got Francesco da Goya, also a court painter in Spain. And it's interesting that the most famous Spanish painter of the 20th century, Picasso, went back to a number of these images and reworked them. But on the left there, you can see that he's got the guitar player, which he did as a picture for tapestries and royal palaces. He did the royal family. He did the major. Clothed and naked and his famous for that. But on the other side, his impairments were getting worse. He had deafness, and by 1793 he could hardly hear at all. And he also, as a result of what happened with the Napoleonic invasions of Spain, his sparring for killing people, he really went against what he believed in, which was the Enlightenment. We had come through this bad period, and we would now be able to sort everything out with reason. That was the age of reason we were supposedly in. And And so his last pictures, his black period, which perhaps we wouldn't call it back today, but he did, which were mainly frescoes in the cottage, but here we have Satan eating his son, or we have the sleep of reason. And so he goes very far, and there's quite a lot of other pictures that he did of sympathetic portrayals of the same people, because he himself was the same person at that time. William Blake, who, very important, was still singing his poems on Jerusalem or Tiger, Tiger in the Night, Blake was bipolar. And he had long periods of very deep depression and then periods of great activity coming out of it. And his favourite print on the right there, he brought up training in the apprenticeship system as an etching engraver, 7 years he did. His father collected a number of etching engravings for him, and he never got rid of this one. When he reached poor times, he had to sell all the others. The one he would never sell was Durer's etching Melancholia, because he related to that. So there are all these strands of mental health going through Western art, if you look for them, which are actually quite important. And there he's doing the pilgrims there, going to Canterbury, of course. Henry Toulouse-Lautrec, another disabled artist, his family interbred with their cousins, and therefore he had many genetic impairments, particularly affected his shortness of stature, brittle bone, and his oversized frame. He spent much of his time in bed for an hour where he learned his artistic skills, but at 18 he had enough of the life of the aristocrats riding across the French country with a shooting ball and so on. He went off to Paris and lived in Montmartre and used his skills there. And this is like the images we have of that time really are directly related to the 1890s to the original track of his pictures. But meanwhile, he was a very sad man. He didn't feel he could have had a proper relationship with anyone, so he frequented prostitutes. But he frequented in such a way that he wanted to exploit them. He tried to show in many of his pictures the actual sensitivity of their life. And he died at a very early age of both alcoholism and syphilis. But he left a huge amount of art behind him. So someone who had no solidarity, no support from any other disabled person, because there was no such movement around in those days. It was a solitary existence, and you had to make it or it broke you. Coming on to visual impairment, this is going across the years. There's quite a few people here with Rembrandt, had stereoscopic vision, so the eyes were looking in different directions. He also was very sympathetic for many disabled people, drawing in 1600 Holland. Leprosy was rife, and you had to wear a white headband to identify yourself, and he had this in his sketches. Or Monet named his family impressionism, like I know it was, we were having a discussion, when did it happen? It was just a label that was given, he's like comfortable and so on, also doing it. But clearly, the Japanese bridge in 1891 in his garden, or to 1924, you can see the effect of the cataracts there on his sight. And clearly, he had very diminished sight. Same for Georgia O'Keeffe, a very progressive female painter in the early 20th century. Music, Pink and Blue, one of the most famous pictures. Not, she says, an erotic image, which is what a lot of men see as an image that she liked. But there, the rock in blue sky is closing off her vision as her sight goes. And in the end, she ended up as just a potter because she said, I refuse to do this. She tried for some of her sisters by instructing them to paint, but she was, in the end, had to give up to not get a new costume. And then David are the same thing. And we still have painters today. Like his son is completely blind, but he still, from his memories, makes his pictures. So, there's no reason why Goyeshek is another blind artist who we have in this very afternoon. So, just because you're not seeing the photos and you don't have images in your head that you want to reproduce for other people to see. That's a watershed with Katharina Carlo, the first artist, woman, probably, a socialist, very strong in Mexican culture, wanting to use her body as a canvas, literally, but also as a main inspiration. Many pictures of her dealing with her postpone. And in fact, we have modern movements like the Sisters of Freedom, which is a women's movement inside of the civil liberties movement, who take it as their leitmotif. Picasso also had his period of depression when his friend shot himself in the head. You can see the mark there. He went into the blue period, and he didn't really recover from that. He then went into the pink period. But he chose as his subject, really, a lot of disabled and destitute people, as his mood was low. So that was how we meant to be characterised, I suppose, at that point in the beginning of the 20th century. Disability is also used as a metaphor. Otto Dix, Kirchner, George Gross, and so on, in the German Expressionist School, they weren't just painting disabled people. They were making a comment about German society. The Weimar Republic was a busted flush, it was broken. Here's the society, here are the pictures. And the Russian painter, Boris Kristof, was a socialist and a Bolshevik. When the Bolshevik revolution was crushed in 1905, he drew this skeleton stalking in the streets or a cat image. But when it was successful in 1920, which has been celebrated in the last couple of weeks, or worried about it in the last couple of weeks, whichever way you look at the media, and this was the image they used for the Russian Revolution image at the Royal Academy, him striding along the Bolshevik. When he painted that, he couldn't get out of his room. He had TV of the spy, and his world was reduced to his room. But he still did amazing paintings all through until his death, well, a bit longer, 27. Mental health again comes back with people like Edward Munch, the most famous, Van Gogh, and we know his classic paintings of theirs. But there were many other people, and when we turn to female artists, we can see similar things like Sigrid Hertigen, who was a Swedish painter, or Camille Claudel, who was a lover of Rodin, a sculptor, or Paula Rego. And if we look at what they write in their pictures, they are basically challenging sexism throughout their work. They were overshadowed in each of those cases by men and had to battle. In fact, Paula writes that, you know, you can't be a mother bringing up children to be an artist. You have to separate yourself off because you are drawn into the oppression that goes with the family bringing it up. And she didn't admit her depression until 2007. There's a series of sketches there. Sigrid was her less important painter husband overshadowed her, and Rodin took many of Camille's works to claim them as his own. Even though she was an accomplished sculptor before she ever became a pupil of his. So this is a pattern that comes out, which, and in this is a British, we don't want to just look at one impression, we want to look at intersecting impressions. And this is a good example of where we can do that. Coming to an end, outside art, we have Hans Grinshorn, who was a psychiatrist in the Weimar institutions, and collected 5,000 works by inmates of institutions from 1918 to 21. He was the first person really to say, look, these people are really saying something important visually about the world and how they're feeling it, and was really the beginning of this outsider art, which then was picked up by John Buffet, and he called it Art Brut, and that went. And now, really, with disability arts, is an outsider art, and it's sort of bringing more into the mainstream. And we have people like Brian Pierce, who had learning degrees adopted by the St. Ives School of Painters, or Bill Jackson, who was a slave, and still was produced, started painting only 80 years later, and he wasn't disabled himself, but he often pictured disabled people. So, Ruler, who's here, Frank Ruler, was in the institutions when it comes to tea. Four programming introduced in 1939 was murdered along with about 100,000 other inmates in mental institutions. So their art is all that's left of them. And that, of course, went on to more than a million disabled people being killed by the Nazis by 1945. So this is, it's in the art, our history is in the art. It's there to be discovered, but is it telling us something else? Well, I think it is. I think this collective in Bristol, who've now been badly cut by the cutbacks and are hardly functioning at all, the artists first, was a very strong collective for 25 years. Many people who've been in long increase in our. This is important because it's saying we are a part of society too. We have something to say. Don't just label us and forget us. So here we are up to date, and I'm going to hand over to my next two speakers, and I'm talking about as part of the disability arts movement. A whole range of people not here, who are going to be kind of really to look at, as well as Nancy Willis, people across the pond, like Rieser, Lira, or Rachel Gass, many artists now. And if you like, beginning to be with some grants from the Arts Council, due to the pioneering work of organisations like SHAPE and so on, fighting for a space for disabled artists to be creative. And we're going to hear from two of them who are pioneering now. Just going to finish on this. It's also largely useful to record. This is one of a movement that I was one of the leaders of, the Movement for Inclusive Education. Richard Branson's art, because her aunt is an artist, Rosa Branson, she does these big paintings, this is 8 foot by 6 foot. There's also one of the RNIB, the different parts of our movement that we recorded in this sort of way. So that's another piece of art that brings disability in. And of course, PME is good, we've got Yunkashan there, who really came up through the mainstream art school as someone with an impairment, not part of the disability movement. He's come through it lately, as he's now more famous. Or someone like Shanita Nislam, who, again, wasn't part of the mainstream disability art movement, but through being a film director and being looking at her own psychosis, that's the only picture I've seen in there, but that is her internal figure who whispers in her ear. She calls it Fred. So art can be very therapeutic, but it can also be very cool. Mark Quinn doesn't really identify himself as a disabled artist, but he has mental health problems, chronic alcoholism, and he concentrated for the first 15 years of his art on his own body, including the hair made of his own blood that's kept in a fridge, or 7 Deadly Sins, emotional detox, trying to get away from his alcoholism, or a nervous breakdown about the mental health breakdown that he had. Moving on then to looking at bodies that are different to the norm in marbles, in Sisson's, looking at his own child, was born with anaphylactic issues, nut allergies and so on. So he became interested, how can we portray hidden impairments? So he did this chemical support of naked bodies lying, but each of them is only alive because they've got chemicals being pumped into their body, whether it's anti-HIV or anti-diabetic, and so on. And then he said, well, what about blind people? And he drew these painted sculptures of people's faces so that blind people could actually feel themselves. And perhaps his most famous, Alison Mapper in Trafalgar Square. And of course, a much bigger version at the Paralympics. And an even bigger version of that at the Venice Biennale, 50 feet high. So that's the most symbol, if you like, of disabled people coming from the cold into the mainstream. It's interesting that it takes someone who's looked at their own condition to see that this is important.